Good day and thank you for inviting me to present the work of the Hydrogen team. Today, I will provide some insight on the results of our research during the Convergence project. This research focused on serpentinization in the Pyrenees and how and to what extent it impacted natural hydrogen production. Recently, hydrogen has raised the interest of decision makers and industry as an efficient source of carbon-free energy. It is commonly considered that its only source is industrial, but it is also a natural resource. There are different natural sources of hydrogen, such as volcanic degassing, but the most important one is the hydrothermal alteration of mantle rocks, peridotites. This process is serpentinization. It is a hydration reaction that transforms peridotites into serpentinites. Peridotites are iron-rich, and this hydration reaction goes with a redox reaction by which the ferrous iron contained in mantle minerals, here olivine, is oxidized into ferric iron, and water is reduced to form hydrogen. Ferric iron is trapped mainly in magnetite, but also in serpentine. This reaction feeds deep-sea hydrothermal vents emitting hydrogen-rich fluids. These vents are found along slow-spreading ridges, where mantle is exhumed along transform faults and oceanic detachment faults. The emission of hydrogen produced by serpentinization along mid-ocean ridges is estimated at roughly 2 million tons per year. This estimate is likely a minimum value for the contribution of oceanic serpentinization to the global hydrogen budget. It doesn't take into account serpentinization occurring at bending fault along subduction zones, or at extensive passive margins where peridotites are exposed on the seafloor. Finally, the serpentinization of peridotites from ophiolites and orogenic massifs exposed on land along suture zone is still poorly known. Is there active serpentinization in these environments? Probably yes. Alkaline springs rich in hydrogen have been known and studied in Oman and in Liguria since more than 30 years. Europe is particularly rich in peridotite massifs, in particular in the Pyrenees. Most of the studied massifs outcrop in the eastern part of the Pyrenean belt, such as the Lerz Massif, that gave its name to the rock type lherzolite, a peridotite rich in clinopyroxene. Our team focused on the less known western massifs. Our research was developed around three PhD projects that aimed to address three main questions. What is the serpentinization and hydrogen production history in the western Pyrenees? What parameters control hydrogen production during serpentinization? And is there evidence for hydrogen seepages in the Western Pyrenees? The first project is based on a petrological, geochemical, and redox study of the peridotite sampled from three Western Pyrenean massifs: Urdache, Turon, and Monteau. The petrographic study of the peridotite samples shows that these massifs comprise mainly lherzolites and that they underwent various degrees of serpentinization. Monteau is characterized also by the occurrence of amphibole, while some of the Urtage serpentinites contain carbonates. The magnesium on silica versus alumina on silica diagram shows the evolution of peridotites during mantle differentiation from primitive mantle to the most refractory end member. The variously serpentinized peridotites from Turon, Monteau, and Urdache overlap in composition with the fertile lherzolites from the Eastern Pyrenees. This indicates that they likely sample the same protolith, a subcontinental lithospheric mantle, and that except for a few samples such as this magnesium-depleted Monto sample, serpentinization didn't strongly modify their bulk composition except for the addition of water. The addition of water is illustrated by the high loss on ignition of our samples. They all have high LOI compared to the Eastern Pyrenees peridotites. The less affected are the Turon samples. Trace elements can provide insight on the composition of the serpentinizing fluids. On these three diagrams, fluid mobile and incompatible elements are on the left-hand side, whilst immobile and compatible elements are on the right-hand side. The Turon data represented here is normalized to the composition of the Eastern Pyrenees lherzolite. They have compositions overall similar to the Eastern Pyrenees peridotite, except for fluid mobile elements. Even though the Turon lherzolite are little altered, similar to the Eastern Pyrenees peridotite, they are characterized by strong enrichment in cesium, antimony and arsenic, elements that are typically enriched in coastal clastic sediments. The data for the more altered Monto and Urdash peridotites is normalized to the average of the Turon lherzolite. They show an even more marked enrichment in crust-derived elements, plus an enrichment in highly incompatible elements such as thorium, niobium, light rare earth, typical of high temperature, hydrothermal alteration, and the formation of amphibole for Monto. They show also enrichment in uranium and strong variation in strontium and calcium, typical of seafloor serpentinization and the formation of carbonates for Urdash. Now, let's look at the products of serpentinization. We observe two types of mineralogical assemblages. We have samples where there is no magnetite, and others where magnetite is present. The samples with magnetites are found in Monto and in the Urdash carbonate-bearing serpentinites. The samples without magnetites are found in Turon and in Urdash. These samples have serpentine that are particularly rich in iron, as illustrated on this diagram. The occurrence of magnetite and the iron distribution in serpentine is independent of the degree of serpentinization. What will be the effect of iron redistribution, and in particular ferric iron redistribution between serpentine and magnetite, for hydrogen production? Our preliminary data indicate that the formation of iron serpentine was a major contributor to the production of hydrogen in our samples, and that it was likely more efficient than the formation of magnetite. These data show also that the mechanisms controlling this redistribution are complex. Mapping of thin section ferric iron distribution shows that it depends strongly on the initial mineralogy and structure of the peridotite and on the development of late veins. So, the three studied massifs have the same protolith, but they display three different reaction paths. What can explain these differences? We posit that it is the geodynamic setting during hydrothermal alteration. Lagabriel and collaborators recently proposed that Urdash preserved a section of mantle exposed on the seafloor in the most distant region of an hyper-extended passive margin. Such an environment would explain the seafloor alteration that characterizes the Urdash massif. In such a geodynamic context, we posit that Monto, that is exposed today along the North Pyrenean fault, sampled the faulted continental margin, and that Turon, that is composed mainly of melanites, sample the deepest part of the necking domain. However, the three massifs share the same history for incipient alteration. They all were infiltrated by fluids that interacted with an evolved crust. Large lithospheric faults probably acted as major fluid flow path for these fluids during the early stages of extension. In this context, what would explain the two types of iron distribution that we observed? Temperature? When serpentinization occurs at less than 200 degrees, no magnetite is produced. This could explain the differences between Montau and Turon. Turon was little affected by brittle deformation and was infiltrated by fluids late during its cooling history. The context is probably more complex in Urdash. There might be an effect of fluid composition that could control the iron distribution in serpentine, via maybe a control of silica or carbonate content in the different fluids driving the serpentinization in this massif. This work is still in progress. The next study was designed to address the question of what parameters control hydrogen production during serpentinization. It uses an experimental approach. The first part of the work consisted in a bibliographic study. It showed that the amount of hydrogen produced during hydrothermal experiments varied by several orders of magnitude for the same pressure and temperature conditions. This raises the questions of the role of the fluid composition and of mineralogy, in particular for accessory phases such as nickel and iron-bearing phases. To investigate these questions, a series of batch experiments were realized at 300 degrees and 300 bars. The initial solid material was a powdered lherzolite. The initial fluid composition was a saline water of controlled pH and to which various amounts of nickel was added. During the experiments, fluid was regularly sampled and analyzed. The fluids were measured to determine their composition in hydrogen and carbon species and for their cationic content. At the end of the experiments, the reacted products were analyzed to determine their mineralogy, bulk rock chemistry, and their redox. The first result of the experiments realized with nickel-bearing fluids is that the production of hydrogen occurs as a two-stage process with time. When compared to experiments realized at the same PT conditions and for peridotite powders having the same grain size, hydrogen production is similar for the first 3 months of experiments, but then it increases strongly, and at the end, the total hydrogen produced is much higher compared to the literature. The final product is serpentinized and magnetite is present. We observe also relics of olivine and pyroxene. Its structure shows a multiscale porosity. A close look at the nickel distribution in the final product shows that nickel is localized in early lizardite that is observed on the reactant mineral boundaries. We posit that nickel could enhance hydrogen production by facilitating serpentine precipitation because of the lower activation energy of nickel serpentine and oxidation of ferrous iron in olivine, especially if nickel-bearing metals form. To test these hypotheses, more experiments will be run with higher nickel concentrations in fluids. Together with thermodynamic modeling, this will provide additional constraints on nickel behavior and reaction mechanism. The third study investigated natural hydrogen seepages in the Western Pyrenees. It is based on a field approach. Different techniques were implemented to identify and localize possible hydrogen seepages. First, multi-gas analysis were realized to determine possible zones of interest. A field gas analyzer was used. It allowed to measure, for instance, methane, carbon dioxide, and hydrogen in the field. Then radon and noble gas measurements were realized in targeted areas and in permanent boreholes. Systematic multi-gas measurements along a regular grid allowed to identify two areas where hydrogen concentrations were high, above 50 ppm per volume. The first is close to Orthez, and the second one is on the North Pyrenean Fault. This line indicates a profile along which geophysical data is available. The geophysical data shows that the regions where hydrogen seepages were identified are also characterized by their seismicity. In the same area, gravimetric data allowed to identify a large and dense body. It was interpreted as a piece of mantle peridotite. It has been proposed that the seismicity in this area revealed fluid movements along faults that in turn triggered serpentinization in the deep peridotite body. This process could be the source of the hydrogen measured at the surface. This would explain also why the highest values were measured along major faults. One of these hydrogen-rich areas was monitored during 1 week in three 1 meter deep boreholes set at an increasing distance from the North Pyrenean Fault. The results show a dramatic increase in the amount of seeping gases towards the fault, in particular for radon and hydrogen. Changes in hydrogen and helium concentrations appear correlated. High helium value indicate a mantle source. Overall, the gas field study indicates that there is circulation of deep source fluids through the main Pyrenean faults. These faults are likely connected to mantle rocks. We posit that active serpentinization takes place and that it is the source of the hydrogen measured at the surface. However, this assumption still needs to be tested. A contribution of radiolysis cannot be excluded. Experiments show that hydrogen production will be enhanced when nickel is present in fluids. Finally, today, hydrogen fluxes are observed and they are detected close to the major faults of the North Pyrenean zone. Thank you for your attention.